Good morning, afternoon, or evening, whatever time you may be listening to the Carving It Up U.S. President's Edition. We are now on episode 6 right now. We got a good one for you guys today. We're going to be coming 5 presidents today, and I just got to say, there's a lot of content for today's show. We're talking Woodrow Wilson, Warren G. Harding, Calvin Coolidge, Herbert Hoover, and finishing off with Franklin D. Roosevelt. Again, a lot's going to be covered today. We're going to discuss 2 world wars, a depression. One of these presidents was just simply scandals galore, and just a number of things that we're going to get to today. But let me bring on my man, Isaac Lawson, who has been on with us throughout this series. Isaac, how you doing, my man?
I'm doing well. It's great to be here.
Yes, sir. Listen, we were talking off air about how we kind of agreed, like, this stage, because we're starting, this is the first episode we're starting an episode with a 21st century president. I'm sorry, a 20th century president. We're going to move forward from there. But this is kind of one of my favorite parts of history, right? We're starting to slowly move into modern times and just the events that lead us to the present day. So before we get into any of this discussion, what's kind of your, I guess, preview for the audience listening as to what to expect in this episode?
You know, during this era, we're really seeing like the modern American government being set up. I think through all of these presidents, you know, even Coolidge, we're seeing kind of the way that things are being run is being changed. The shape of government is being changed. And we're just seeing the modern system that we're kind of used to and presidents that are kind of more in line to what we're used to seeing today.
Right. And it's definitely something that's, you know, it's a part of history that, you know, like you said, I think after the presidency of Teddy Roosevelt, we kind of a William Howard Taft, who's really we talked about, he's 19th century president in the 20th century. Mm-hmm. After him, like you said, even Calvin Coolidge, who's one of the most, we'll get into him later, one of the most conservative presidents, certainly of recent history, you see them sort of change and start to take on more power. The office itself takes on more power. And that really culminates in the final president we'll discuss. But first, let's talk about where we pretty much left off the last episode, the election of 1912. And I don't know about necessarily the candidates individually, but I will say this. Of all of the elections that this presidential elections that this country has ever had, I think in terms of big names, this has got to be at the top of the list. Because you've got William Howard Taft running with the Republicans. You've got New Jersey Governor Woodrow Wilson running on the Democratic side. And then basically you've got the greatest third-party candidate by a mile in history in Teddy Roosevelt running under the new progressive or better known as Bull Moose party. And so, you know, it's really a crazy turn of events because as we sort of touched on the last episode, Teddy Roosevelt was dissatisfied with what his basically handpicked successor was doing in terms of his policy. And he says, okay, I want back in the White House. Well, he tries to wrestle the nomination away from Taft. He fails because the Republicans favor Taft's more conservative views. And so, you know, Teddy Roosevelt being Teddy Roosevelt, he says, okay, I'm going to basically create my own party to try and run. And just talk about that election cycle and the stark contrast in all 3 of the major candidates.
Yeah, I think that, you know, that the differences are probably the most interesting, like, parts of this election. Because, you know, you have Taft, who is probably, like, the more traditional Republican candidate of the day. He is less kind of shaky and radical than either of the people he's running against. But he also is probably, at least in the role of president, the least likable of the 3, just kind of public persona. And part of that doesn't help that he's getting attacked from 2 sides and they're trying to paint him that way. But also, like, the fact that he didn't like being president does kind of shine through to the public. Like, they were picking up on that. And he's just tired and doesn't really want to campaign. But he also is, and I think rightfully so, stubborn and is like, I'm not going to let Teddy take this away from me. And that's an interesting dynamic there. And then you look at Roosevelt, who is, you know, a progressive Republican, at the time. He really made, you know, significant changes to the Republican Party during his time as president. But he also is not, he doesn't care that much about the party. He cares about the policy, and he really, really cares about the office. And he will kind of do whatever he can to get back there. And we see that here with him trying to create his own party and, you know, going, you know, full force kind of brutally against Taft. He lobbies just really kind of cruel insults about his weight and about his personality and things that are just like not necessary, and they're not what Taft is doing to him, at least initially at the beginning of the election. And then you have Woodrow Wilson, who I'll go ahead and start off. You know, I told you this before, before we recorded this episode, he's not my favorite president. He's probably my least favorite. But he's someone who is, you know, for the Democrats, very progressive. He is progressive, at least in foreign policy and kind of the size and the scope of government. But, you know, he also has a pretty stark contrast from Teddy Roosevelt about kind of the way that they think government should be run and kind of in what way the government should be larger and more powerful. They kind of are viewing different sides and different areas of kind of the same general idea. And basically what happens is, you know, Roosevelt splits the Republican Party's vote by, you know, leaving and takes the progressive wing of the Republican Party with him, at least for that time. And you have Taft, who's getting kind of a traditional Republican vote. You have Roosevelt, who's getting the progressive Republican vote. And then you're winding up with Wilson, who's able to, you know, rally the Democrats around him and is able to come through this election as the winner. But I dare to say that I'm not even sure he was the most well-liked of the three candidates. I think Roosevelt was probably the most popular of all three, but he just wasn't, he alienated people by running against Taft and by not giving up after he lost the primary against Taft. And I think that's kind of what tore this apart. But if you're Woodrow Wilson, you're thrilled because this is like the dream for someone running against, you know, a party that's had power for quite a while. You know, if I'm running for president and my opponents are literally tearing their party apart, you know, that's great for me. And it did work out for Wilson because he wound up becoming president because of it.
That's it. I mean, you summed it up perfectly. Teddy Roosevelt's popularity actually kind of backfired in a way because, like you said, you do have the progressives who love Roosevelt. You have the more traditional Republicans who love Taft. Mm-hmm. And all the or at least not all is a strong word, but the vast majority of the Democrats obviously vote for their guy, Woodrow Wilson. Mm-hmm. And, you know, he pretty much just waltzes right into the White House. And again, like we discussed kind of in the last episode, we won't go too far into it, but, you know, Taft was kind of thrilled at this. He was just excited to get out of the White House. Mm-hmm. But again, like you said, he was running just to say, hey, you know, Mr. Roosevelt, you're not going to bully me without, you know, without a fight. So, but yeah, Teddy was really the most popular candidate, I think, because of his personality, right? Woodrow Wilson was kind of a cold, somewhat aloof, not like this unapproachable person, but not as big of a personality. Like you think Teddy Roosevelt, you think big personality. Mm-hmm. And so that's how Woodrow Wilson got in the White House. So here we go. Woodrow Wilson starting off this episode.
Number 28, Woodrow Wilson, Democrat, 1913 to 1921, 56 years old, from New Jersey.
So Woodrow Wilson comes to the White House. He's the first Democrat to win since Grover Cleveland, and he was born on the December the 28th of 1856 to Joseph Ruggles Wilson and Jesse Jeanette Woodrow. He married Ellen Axon in 1865. They had three children together. And, you know, he was a Southerner by birth. He was actually, I believe, the only president to have lived under the old Confederacy in the state of Georgia. He was kind of an academic. He was the only president to hold a PhD. He was an avid golfer, a very religious man. And he enjoyed Broadway shows, movies, and just talk about kind of his personality and how he was perceived, I guess, by the American public and even within people within his own administration.
Wilson is someone that I personally, when I read him, I have a hard time getting a strong sense of his personality for myself. But he's someone that, from what I've read, you know, someone that was pretty popular. I know that his second wife would kind of host dinner parties that were kind of like the envy of people in Washington, D.C. And he was someone that kind of, I think, exemplified some of that Southern hospitality at times. But he also could be kind of cool and aloof at times. And there's a little bit of a contrast there. And, you know, even that kind of coolness to his personality and will kind of play in later in his life and, you know, especially the final year of his presidency and the way that his wife is able to handle things then, which we'll talk about later. I've also read some accounts that he kind of be dismissive to people that he thought weren't as intelligent as he was. But I've kind of seen some conflicting reports about that. But I feel like that's kind of an interesting thing to note. Cause he was a smart guy. I don't think anyone's going to argue about that. He was very smart. He had a PhD and, you know, I think it's just an interesting contrast there. He had his people and he was very social and friendly with his people, but there was also kind of an aloofness to him from what I've read.
Yeah. And that's kind of, you know, how people, I mean, even sort of the exterior, he you know, anybody who wants to Google a picture of a President Wilson, like he did have somewhat of an emotionless kind of cold exterior, like you mentioned. But I think, I'm just going to dive right into this before we even get into his presidency. I think you can't tell the story of Woodrow Wilson without talking about his dark views on race. In my opinion, of the 20th century presidents, I think he's the most racist we've ever had.
I would agree.
And I mean, obviously, you just go down the list. He was the first Southerner since Zachary Taylor to win the White House. He was an ardent supporter of segregation. He wasn't one of those presidents who just kind of kept at arm's length, didn't really want to address it. No, he was just a flat out supporter of it. Go ahead.
Well, I was going to say he resegregated parts of the federal government that had been desegregated, from kind of McKinley to Taft, including most notably was, you know, large parts of the military had been desegregated, especially when Roosevelt was president. And, he very quickly undid all of that, and the military remained segregated until after World War II.
There you go. I mean, he pushed it like you mentioned. I appreciate you throwing that in, because that was something I was going to get to as well. Is that like Teddy Roosevelt was kind of one of the first presidents. I didn't know McKinley was involved with that, but Teddy Roosevelt was desegregating not just the military, but I believe he put a black man in one of the, not the cabinet positions, but as a, oh my goodness, as one of the leaders of one of the departments. I can't remember what it was, but, William Crum was the customs officer. He was appointed by Roosevelt, and, you know, Woodrow Wilson adamantly opposed this. And, you know, he had a cabinet filled with self-described white supremacists, and, his 8 years in office was the worst era of, race-based violence since Reconstruction. And a few episodes, we talked about that, and anybody who knows anything about what happened during Reconstruction, it was just a disaster.
And then, you know, I think there's also, in this story, from my understanding, most people tend to know, but you know, the first movie ever shown in the White House was Birth of a Nation, which was lost cause propaganda. And that was played by President Wilson to his cabinet to promote that narrative. And you know, he spoke quite a bit about that movie and his views and his admiration for it. And it's something that, you know, I think that and his support of even pushing that narrative that, you know, the KKK, you know, was a justified group. You know, that was something that he was actively involved in.
That's it. He not only, like I said, he wasn't just a passive president in regards to segregation. He adamantly was all in for it. I have read conflicting reports about not whether they showed Birth of a Nation in the White House, but whether he was kind of flip-floppy on whether he supported the KKK or not. He spoke for it, and then he spoke against it. You know, that's not something that you should have to be getting yourself entangled, but Wilson apparently felt the need to do so. The point is, he was, let's try and transition from that, because again, that's, like I said, you can't tell the story of him without mentioning that. But as president, he was the first president to deliver a State of the Union address to Congress in person, which is a tradition, obviously, that is carried on to this day. It hadn't been done since, I believe, Thomas Jefferson. Every president since then, up until Woodrow Wilson, just delivered their State of the Union in by mail to Congress. He delivered it in person. But his goal, kind of in his first term as president, was to fulfill his progressive agenda. He called it the New Freedom. And one of the contributions he made to this cause, for which he promoted, was creating the Federal Reserve to manage the U.S. currency system. Obviously, that is carried on to this day as well. So, if you would talk about sort of his sort of reasoning behind wanting to create the Federal Reserve.
Yes, let me pull up my notes real quick.
Because I mean that's yeah. every. All presidents obviously have their own agenda. His was the New Freedom, but just talk about why he wanted to push that.
Yeah, so he this had to do with the bank war, but it's like that goes all the way back to the 1830s and Andrew Jackson, which is actually somebody that I'll actually mention later in this episode as well in relation to Wilson. You know, we hadn't had a government-run central bank since then, and you know, we've discussed in several of these episodes, you know, I think including even in the episode with Jackson, after, you know, the Central Bank of the United States was gone, that there were a number of kind of like economic disasters that happened and major financial crises. And basically there was a debate that by creating, you know, a Federal Reserve, that it would give the government more control over not just the inflation, but over just kind of the economy and the monetary system as a whole. And it was something that could help dissuade those financial crises. So that, from what I've read, is kind of what inspired Wilson to want to, you know, I can't think of the word all of a sudden, but to, you know, have the government kind of step into the banking system and create the Federal Reserve, and to give the government more control over currency in the economy.
Right. And it was, again, like you said, it was something that was very much, you know, sort of the typical progressive Democratic view of wanting to have the government control these specific programs and things. But we move to 1914 now, and he's facing two crises almost simultaneously, because in August, World War One begins. Just as that's beginning, the president's wife, Ellen, died at the White House of Bright's disease, which is a kidney ailment. And again, we talked about Wilson's kind of cold exterior, and he tried to keep his mourning kind of away from the public and from other people, but he was obviously devastated at this. So, like, about the sort of impact of Ellen's passing, what do you think it had on him, especially as this worldwide crisis is just now beginning?
You know, I think, like, obviously for any spouse that, you know, has lost their significant other, you know, that's like a deep form of grieving, and there's not really another one like it. You know, it definitely affected him. I've read, and this is getting a little bit farther forward, but he, you know, through this grieving process, and then also through his time personally battling the Spanish flu, he, there are a lot of accounts that he became a much more withdrawn person, that he didn't like to socialize as much, and kind of those, that kind of coldness that had kind of been an underlying part of his personality became a much more firm and prominent part of who he was and how he interacted with people. So it kind of led him to withdraw from people, become more firm, and become less of an optimist. I've read before about how on a number of issues, whether it's the League of Nations or just some of his other progressive policies that were more domestic in nature, that he became a lot less optimistic in the way that those things were going to work. And it even resulted in changes to negotiations at the end of World War One.
And I've read also that, you know, he did sort of fall into a deep depression that did kind of last the rest of his life. He never, obviously, we'll talk about later, he did remarry. That becomes very significant. But he really never, I mean, understandably so, he never really got over his wife's passing. And I believe it was reported that an aide once found him muttering him to himself, "My God, what am I going to do?" So it was a very, very rough period for Wilson. And again, as he mourns his, as he's mourning his wife, the Great War in Europe is persisting. And, you know, America's position in the war is becoming imminent. Like, we've got to make a decision. Are we going to are we going to oppose neutrality? What are we going to do? And very few in the country wanted anything to do with the war. And so Wilson did indeed pledge neutrality. This ended up being a mistake because German ships frequently attacked British ones that often carried American citizens. And a huge point in this war, at least in America's eventual involvement, was in 1915, the sinking of the Lusitania, which killed 128 Americans. And again, there's public outrage over this, but Wilson kind of continue to keep a cool head. He really did not want to get involved with this war. But what were sort of the events that that pushed America into World War One?
Mm-hmm. It was, you know, mostly kind of what you already said. You know, there were American civilians that were kind of getting caught in the crossfire, especially when it came to ships that were being sunk by the Germans. You know, there were American civilians that were dying. And as that continued to happen, and just even Americans who were in Europe for various reasons that died as the war kind of spread and continued, people became more and more outraged. There was also a concern that the war was just going to continue to drag on in Europe, and about the way that just kind of a continuous state of warfare and truly brutal warfare like World War One was, that, you know, if that continued on, that it could be detrimental to everyone around the world, and that it could potentially drag more and more countries in until we were kind of all in a constant state of warfare. So there was kind of a push from two fronts. So there were some people that thought that we should intervene to try to help end the conflict and kind of resolve it before it like kind of continued to grow in size and scope. And then there was also the view that just like, you know, there are Americans that are already being affected by this and are already being killed. And if we are going to wait to get involved, you know, at what point do we wait? At what point are we going to draw the line on how many kind of Americans have to be affected by this for it to be time to intervene?
It was very similar in many ways to when McKinley was president, and we just flat out did not have a choice but to get involved with the Spanish-American War, obviously for different reasons, but, you know, sort of the same motives that brought us into that war. Mm-hmm. But at the end of this pivotal year, 1915, December the 18th, Woodrow Wilson became the first president since John Tyler and Grover Cleveland to get married while in office. He got married to a woman, actually a Washington widow named Edith Bowling Galt. And less than a year later, he barely won re-election, becoming the first Democratic incumbent to do so since, as you mentioned, Andrew Jackson.
Who did so. And that was going to be the other time that I mentioned him in the episode. Which I think, you know, that this is a good example. His re-election, I think, is an important note because, you know, he became at the time and for a while kind of a symbol of kind of strength within the Democrat Party. And that was notable. That was notable because he was someone who was viewed as kind of this new figure for the future of the party and being able to, you know, do things like, again, the first Democrat to win re-election since Andrew Jackson. That's a significant period of time. And not to hate on the party or anything, but their presidents between then, you know, had some major issues and reasons why they weren't necessarily these major prominent figures. People like Martin Van Buren and like Franklin Pierce and James Buchanan were not becoming these kind of national heroes in the nation's mind. And Wilson was somebody that the party, you know, going forward and after his death, could kind of market and harken back to and kind of use in kind of their like party's kind of propaganda and marketing. And that's why I think he's really notable kind of for moving forward. And especially as we get to the the second Roosevelt presidency, because, you know, he's drawing on a lot of similar themes.
Yes.
So Wilson in a lot of ways helps kind of reinvent the Democratic Party of the day.
Yeah, and I think in a lot of ways he was somebody who the party could kind of wrap their arms around, right? Like, to his credit, you know, whether you agree or disagree with his policies, unlike some of the presidents you mentioned, a guy like Martin Van Buren, or even to a certain degree, you're talking about Franklin Pierce, James Buchanan. You've got a guy in Woodrow Wilson who is holding firm to a fault, but holding firm to his beliefs. And, you know, that's something, okay, the Democratic Party or those who voted for it were like, hey, you know, he's pretty much stayed consistent throughout this whole route. Why on earth will we move on from him and go in a different direction? Because as you said, he kind of was reinventing the party into what they believed it should be. Mm-hmm. So he, again, like you said, he does win re-election. Let's see, 1832. So that was 84 years. So, you know, it's a long gap in between, but Woodrow Wilson wins re-election. And in early 1917, Germany declared that no more American ships would be spared the wrath of warfare. And so, like you said, at this point, we just didn't have a choice. And so on April 2nd of that same year, Woodrow Wilson asked Congress for a declaration of war against Germany. And in that speech, in the Declaration of War, he later sent out a message that would become essential in American foreign policy. He said, quote, "The world must be safe for democracy." That was pretty much how he kind of symbolized the speech and us going into that war. And, you know, this is really, we're now kind of moving into the defining moment, or the defining last couple of years of Woodrow Wilson's presidency, because we begin our involvement in the war and Woodrow Wilson has this idea of something he believes that could keep the peace, could prevent any other wars from happening. He called it the League of Nations, which would be an international body that would settle disputes without war, and it would absolutely become his greatest pursuit as president. And so during the war, again, Wilson, like I think a lot of Democrats at the time, very domestic-minded guy. And so with the war, he's letting, you know, generals like John Black, Jack Pershing make most of the decisions. But he never gave any major commands to General Pershing. He only gave him one command, and that was to keep a separate army in order to show how separate our commitment was to the war. Mm-hmm. And so that was kind of his way about going about it. So how describe Wilson as a war president? Because with war presidents, we talk about, you know, even, you know, sometimes we talk about James Madison, War of 1812, obviously Lincoln. Later on this episode, we're going to discuss FDR. But I don't think Woodrow Wilson's legacy, does his involvement as president in World War I, is that really even a major part of his legacy or something we talk about? And just sort of describe his the way he went about things.
Mm-hmm. You know, it's interesting, even on like a larger note, that like World War I is not talked about as much in the U.S. And part of that is because the warfare did not as even directly correlate to us as other wars that we fought have been, or in more recent wars, we haven't had kind of, you know, the 24-hour news and the technology that we have now to kind of broadcast the images of it back home. Which I think is interesting, and I think it affects the way that we view him as a wartime president, because he most certainly was. It preoccupied, you know, a significant portion of his presidency. And I think that, you know, there are a lot of things that he did as a wartime president that have been echoed since then in the wars that we fought. You know, putting on a really strong face and kind of saying, like, we're going to win this, was something that he did, and kind of having an optimistic note publicly, even though privately, especially during the peace process, he was not optimistic about kind of the results of what was going to happen, which a lot of historians will credit to his depression. But, you know, kind of trying to rally the public to kind of help kind of ration things and help support the war effort, and kind of, you know, the U.S. is in a war, so we're all in a war. That kind of rhetoric that we've seen since then has been a really important part of the way that the United States goes about war, and the way that, you know, the public is involved, and there's broad public support for wars is what we generally want, and kind of push for from a governmental level. You know, a lot of that rhetoric comes from Wilson, and it worked. You know, he had a lot of public support. The public liked him during the war because he made people feel optimistic about it. He made the United States feel like a world power. And, you know, this is we talked in the last episode about how when the U.S. defeated Spain was kind of when it was undeniable that the U.S. was starting to reach that status by beating one of these old European powers. But, you know, now them coming into World War One and, you know, playing a pivotal role at the end of the war and in the peace process, you know, it's undeniable at this point. The U.S. is a world power. And by kind of echoing that in some of his speeches and then the way that he acted, you know, the American public picked up on that and kind of latched onto it. And I think that there is a credit to him there just in kind of the public persona and the rhetoric that he was putting out during the war. And I think it revolutionized the way that America thinks about and, you know, kind of the way that wartime presidents are expected to act.
Yeah, and it matters. And like you said, the way you put yourself out there and the message that you do convey to the American people absolutely matters. One thing I will say, though, that I don't know if it gets enough attention or if maybe the criticism shouldn't go as much to Woodrow Wilson in the thing I'm about to discuss here, but he certainly does deserve some blame for at least not stopping it from happening. And that would be the Sedition and Espionage Acts of 1918. Which made it a crime to criticize the government. And basically, it's sort of a weird, ironic twist because Woodrow Wilson, I talked about the quote earlier, he said the world must be made safe for democracy. Well, we can't criticize the government. And again, Wilson himself did not push this bill. This isn't like the League of Nations or, you know, the Federal Reserve or anything like that. But he is, you know, kind of sitting back and just letting it happen. And so that's, I think that's an interesting, you know, piece of what he did during the war. But only 19 months after we entered the war, due to the strength of our armed forces and that of our allies, Germany surrendered. And we move into the final step towards the peace agreement, which would be decided in Paris. And this meant that Wilson would become the first sitting president to travel to Europe. And he set sail on December the 4th of 1918. With the hopes of a peace agreement that would last for all time. And he was very, very well received overseas. There was, you know, children threw roses at his feet. He was, I think he was referred to by some as the savior out of the West. Like, he was just beloved out in Europe. They traveled to Rome, London, and obviously in Paris. And, you know, he had to make a number of compromises in Paris. But once it was all said and done, he got what he wanted with the Treaty of Versailles, when it was signed, which is a provision, for the establishment of the League of Nations. So he's starting to sense, okay, we're getting closer to what I want. And, once he gets back to America, it kind of goes kaput, right, with his proposal for the League of Nations. So talk about how sort of those events played out and how it just blew up.
Yeah, so Wilson is part of his kind of larger, kind of broader progressive vision of, you know, peace after the war. And it was his progressive vision to some extent beforehand, but the war kind of solidified it. It was to kind of create this larger international, intergovernmental, you know, kind of world government sort of system that would kind of create a place for countries to kind of work out their disputes peacefully and possibly put an end to war as we know it. And, you know, this idea would eventually be created in to some extent in the United Nations. The League of Nations and what he wanted it to be was going to be more powerful than the UN is today, and would kind of have some more ability to some extent to intervene in its member nations. And this was something that people at home in America did not like, and politicians, you know, kind of especially spun it out of control. And so while Wilson is going around the world and kind of advocating for this and his peace plan, meanwhile in the States, you know, the Republican Party is really starting to push out the narrative that this is not what the American people want, and that this is not going to be in the best interest for America. And, you know, even today there are people who dispute about whether the League of Nations would have been a good thing or not. But, you know, Wilson comes home and starts to try to advocate for it and even goes on a speaking tour. But he just can't convince the American people that the League of Nations is something that is going to be beneficial for them. And because of that, you know, when the Senate elections come up, Republicans are able to get a majority. And it is a narrow majority, but it stops the League of Nations treaty from being ratified in the Senate. And because of that, the United Nations the United States is not a member of the League of Nations, and it will remain that way until the League of Nations is ultimately resolved.
Right. And, you know, he, like you said, it was sort of, so the Republicans put it out there that this isn't good. And so Woodrow Wilson says, okay, the American people like me, they don't like the League of Nations. Okay, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to go on a speaking tour and see if I can rally public opinion to where, you know, the Republicans maybe would not have had a choice but to go with it. However, on this speaking tour, he had some major health issues. His doctor said, hey, don't push it. He ignored them. And while he was in Pueblo, Colorado, he suffered a physical collapse. And so he canceled the rest of his tour and returned to Washington. And then on October 2nd of 1919, he suffered a serious stroke that left him paralyzed on his right side and blind in his right eye. So this completely just, you know, impaired the president. And this, see, this to me is where, like, and this is why I love doing this podcast, Isaac, because, you know, this is a part of American history that I feel like does not get talked about enough. We essentially, Woodrow Wilson wasn't just completely, you know, out of here, but he was limited. I mean, he was very much limited physically, mentally. And we kind of had a female president running the country for the next 15 months. And that was his wife. And you know, Edith Wilson took great care of her husband. She kept most visitors away, and she covered up the severity of his condition. And so how she sort of kind of became like a president, she took it upon herself to relay important information to Woodrow Wilson and then report back on what he was thinking. And, you know, just talk about like sort of this very interesting and to me fascinating part of American history that Edith Wilson was kind of the president for 15 months.
So at the very beginning, when after Wilson had his stroke, you know, he was completely out of it. And there was kind of question of what was going to happen. And Edith Wilson, along with a few other kind of close confidants of President Wilson, decided that the best thing to do was to make sure that he remained in office as president. So what they did was they limited the number of people that were allowed to go see him. They limited it to Edith herself and the White House doctor. And then she basically kind of stood her ground and said to the cabinet, you know, if you want to talk to my husband, you're talking to him through me. And then when they kind of scoffed at that, she was like, she even went, I believe even threatened to fire some people and was like, well, I'll tell him to fire you. And they were like, well, you can't do that. And she was like, I'm his wife, who's to say? And, you know, she was able to kind of bully these men into submission and to a point where she was basically able to kind of run the country while her husband, you know, recovered. And then afterwards kind of slowly transitioned back to him having control of the government. And, you know, she made these decisions. She at first was even forging his signature to sign documents. And then, you know, as he recovered, he started to sign the documents again. And she would bring them out and kind of give them to staff members into the cabinet and just say, this is what President Wilson said. And, you know, there wasn't really anything they could do about it. They just either had to trust her or they could kind of stage, like, to some extent, a coup. And, you know, this wasn't revealed until years later when she wrote a memoir and kind of revealed this kind of scandalous information. And even at the time when she first wrote it, people questioned it because they were like, there's no way that that's possible. But it was true. It's been backed up by a number of kind of firsthand witness accounts and, you know, her account of the situation and the way that she kind of helped step in to kind of stop what at the time would have been a constitutional crisis. She kind of stopped it from occurring, for better or worse, depending on your view of kind of how that should have been handled.
I did not know Edith Wilson wrote a memoir. I'm going to need to, you know, sort of check out what's in that. That sounds very, very fascinating. But again, as Wilson is recovering from this, you know, physical ailment and she's relaying information back and forth, the League of Nations is still like up in the air as to whether it's even going to, you know, be ratified by the Senate, which, as you mentioned, the Republicans did control. And in mid-March, Senator Henry Cabot Lodge and pro-treaty Democrats actually suggested a treaty with reservations but Wilson refused. And so they kind of suggested, hey, we'll compromise a little bit. And Wilson's like, no, I want it the way I want it, which, as we often see in politics, backfires big time. And in on March 19th of 1920, Wilson was informed that the treaty and therefore the League of Nations had been rejected by the U.S. Senate and pretty much met its final defeat. It was over. And he replied, quote, they have shamed us in the eyes of the world. And so this was pretty much it. That he passed the rest of his term fairly quietly because, you know, in his view, there was really, you know, if the League of Nations isn't going to get passed, what am I really supposed to do? I'm, you know, I've just suffered a stroke. I'm paralyzed on my side here and I'm blind. Like, this is a bad time for me right now. So the failure was that the fight for the League of Nations more than likely set ourselves and the world up to fight another world war. And so it's just a disaster all the way around in how Wilson's unwilling to compromise and just how he suffered a stroke beforehand. It's bad on both ends of the spectrum. And he actually, surprisingly, despite his physical condition, he pushed again to run for a third term in the election of 1920. But powerful leaders in the Democratic Party advised him not to because of his health. And his condition was actually so dire that he was unable to attend his successor's inauguration. So, you know, he certainly was not capable of serving another 4 years in the White House. And so he pretty much passed through the rest of his term. Of course, we'll get into his successor, but he basically, of course, dealt with these health issues the rest of his life, and he passed away on February the 3rd of 1924 at the age of 67. His final words were, quote, I'm a broken piece of machinery. When the machine is broken, I am ready. So this is one of the more significant administrations that's really not talked about that much, which, you know, looking back at history, it really shaped whether or not World War II did happen, whether or not some of the progressive policies that we'll get into with FDR, whether they were able to get pushed. In some ways, it was that Wilson was not able to fulfill his goals and his mission. And so this was sort of a rallying cry for the Democrats to go forward from here. So just talk about kind of Woodrow Wilson's legacy to kind of wrap him up and just sort of where he stands in terms of presidential significance.
You know, I think a lot of times we like to credit Franklin Roosevelt as the president that kind of turned a corner and made the Democratic Party a progressive party. And I really think that credit belongs to Woodrow Wilson. You know, he's the one that, even though Roosevelt was already a political figure at this time, you know, Franklin Roosevelt, you know, credits Woodrow Wilson for kind of inspiring him to kind of push for these progressive policies in the way that he does. And I think that in a lot of ways, the modern Democratic Party, I think in the way that it has, you know, kind of a strong public outreach arm, that it, you know, kind of has a very strong view of kind of protecting relationships with our traditional allies at home and abroad, and continuing to kind of expand the shape and scope of government, I think all of that goes, you know, straight back to Woodrow Wilson. And I think he's the one that defined a lot of those ideals for them. You know, I think obviously their views on race have changed for the better. You know, I think that in all those other areas, I think he really encapsulates a lot of what the modern party still stands for. You know, I think that he is notable because of that and because of that shift that he makes. And I think that also the conversations that he just starts on a national level, like with the League of Nations, you know, even though he is not able to get that done, you know, we see in the United Nations, in the post-World War II order, a lot of those things kind of echo his vision for post-World War I Europe. So I think that, you know, that's very... I think it's notable kind of his lasting effect going forward.
Absolutely. And again, he is, we talked about Teddy Roosevelt in the last episode and how he sort of changed the office of president. You could say Woodrow Wilson kind of did the same for his party, as you mentioned. So But yeah, he's certainly when you look at a lot of presidential rankings lists, some have him really high in the top 10, some don't. They have him in the bottom half of president. So he's kind of, depending on who you ask, you know, some people may say he's a great president. Some may say, you know, I couldn't stand the guy. Like, you know, he's really kind of a mixed bag, or a mixed bag of presidents where, you know, depending on who you ask, you know, in terms of what he got done, what he did not get done, whether he could have gotten it done had he not had the stroke. It's just a really, it's kind of, in my view, sort of a what if story, but in the same way, listen, you could have gotten it done to a certain degree, but he's certainly not an insignificant president by any stretch of the imagination. We move now to a president who was certainly in policy very different from Woodrow Wilson, and the country was kind of in more of a conservative mood. It was the campaign slogan for Wilson's successor was sort of the return to normalcy. I don't think that was his campaign slogan, but that was sort of the moniker around Wilson's successor, a man named Warren G. Harding.
Number 29, Warren G. Harding, Republican, 1921 to 1923, 55 years old, from Ohio.
Warren G. Harding. Boy, this guy's a character. So he was born on November the 2nd of 1965 to George and Phoebe Harding. He married Florence Kling in 1891, and they had no children together. I want to put an emphasis on those two didn't have children together. This will become significant later in the story, ladies and gentlemen. But he was the only president, this is a fun fact, to be elected on his birthday. And again, his successful campaign, he touted the return to normalcy, sort of a move back into, I guess, conservative politics. And he was, again, very much unlike Wilson. He had a big, colorful personality. He was a gambler, a drinker, a womanizer. And he was not really an ambitious man. He's kind of been somebody who's been characterized as someone who really wasn't that fit to be president. So talk about President Harding's personality and why the country did indeed go in this direction.
Harding was definitely kind of like an optimist. He had kind of a really warm public perception, but he also kind of had like a sternness to him that people really liked. You know, he, in his campaign, while he modernized a lot of things, for like a Republican presidential campaign, he also had, it was also very traditional at the same time. You know, he embraced some of the front porch campaigning techniques, but also his campaign started train tours and things like that that weren't necessarily in the norm. So you had this interesting mix between somebody who was kind of viewed as like a traditionalist, but also was kind of exploring this kind of new future and the present and the things that kind of the country had before that it hadn't had before. So you have that weird mix there. I always, kind of when I'm reading about Harding, I just get a sense that he just seems kind of fun to be around. Like in some of the stories about him being like a newspaper editor, they just are entertaining stories. And then obviously we'll get into some of his issues later on and why maybe he might not be the best company, you know, morally. He's someone that I feel like the nation is kind of at ease with, if that makes sense.
Yeah. I mean, it's sort of a sense of, you know, things are going to be more quiet, like you said, traditional. We're not going to really make any big noise. And like a lot of Republican presidents before and certainly some of the ones after him, he relied heavily on his cabinet, which, you know, wasn't a terrible cabinet. You know, you had men like the Secretary of State was Charles Evans Hughes. His Secretary of Commerce was Herbert Hoover. So it was not a terrible cabinet that he had to rely on. It will sort of come back to bite him later on. But I guess you could say sort of his most influential achievement was the Budget and Accounting Act of 1921, which was passed at his persuasion, and it gave the executive branch more power over federal spending. So it's kind of funny to see like a conservative president kind of giving the, like, cause let's be honest, Teddy Roosevelt was Republican. He was no conservative. And so with President Harding, it's weird to see kind of a conservative president outwardly pushing to give the executive office more power, as I think, I know we keep going back to Teddy Roosevelt, but I think this does kind of point back to his legacy on that, making it somewhat acceptable for the man in charge to give himself more power, at least in the eyes of the Senate, or I'm sorry, not the Senate, but just the House of Representatives as a whole. And it also required the president to submit an annual budget to Congress. So, you know, really, Isaac, this bill was something that has really become significant even to this day.
Mm-hmm. I'm so sorry. I blanked all of a sudden. Don't worry about it. I'm so sorry.
Yeah, I mean,
the bank bill.
Yeah, the bank, the Budget and Accounting Act of 1921.
Yes, I'm so sorry.
Yeah, don't worry about it.
No, it definitely is. And I think that we see here, kind of at the beginning of the episode, when I talked about how, you know, Wilson and Teddy Roosevelt kind of moved their parties and were kind of revolutionary and kind of creating the modern sense of who their parties were going to be by both being progressives kind of on different sides. I think we're seeing a little bit of the way that that is kind of playing out for the Republican Party here. While we have a candidate that is definitely still very traditional for the Republican Party at the time, he also is kind of doing what is a more progressive policy. But I think we're seeing here kind of more of the clear definition of it. He's doing it in a conservative way, which is a weird way to kind of phrase it. But he's doing it in a way that while it is kind of expanding the size of government and some of its powers, he's doing it in a way that's basically more of an argument of, I'm making what we already have more effective, and I'm not necessarily just trying to expand it. And, you know, that's kind of a way that Republicans will kind of frame their arguments going forward, kind of saying, we're not trying to make it bigger, we're trying to make what we already have more effective, and if that makes it bigger, that's just part of it. And I think that, you know, we're seeing kind of these narratives are starting to kind of be more clearly formed in both parties during this era. I think that the budget bill is a good example of that.
Yeah, it is. And he also, you know, to his credit, he convened an international conference in Washington that ended up resulting in a historic arms reduction agreement between the naval powers of the world. And so this, along with the Budget and Accounting Act, made Harding, while in office, one of the most popular presidents in history. So, like, talk about, we kind of discussed his public perception, but how the public viewed him and any other major pieces of legislation or things that happened during his time in office that really just put him on this pedestal, and the people absolutely loved him.
Mm-hmm. You know, he, again, had kind of a warm public persona, but he also was kind of, I talked about sternness earlier, he was viewed as somebody who kind of was making decisions and getting things done. So, like, you know, some notable things to talk about would probably be, you know, he goes on like this big train tour, which we'll get to later on. But, you know, that's something that isn't, that hasn't been a norm for a president to really tour the nation just to tour the nation and to get out and talk to people and see people. And, you know, we see kind of him speaking out and kind of taking a middle of the road stance on things like organized labor and civil rights. While he definitely has a clear view and kind of where he lands on things, when he talks about it publicly, he kind of makes it seem like he's somewhere in the middle and he's still kind of working through what he thinks about it. And those are things, the way that he portrays it is really effective, and it kind of makes people on both sides of the aisle kind of feel heard. And that's something that I feel like helps his public persona a lot, where he's kind of seen as kind of this head honcho, like stern, smart guy, but he's also seen as someone who's friendly and warm and that the public can relate to. Warren does a good job of kind of riding that line, like few politicians have really been able to, of kind of keeping sometimes his views quiet and kind of taking a middle of the road stance and being able to get people to kind of latch onto that and like that.
Yeah, and really the train tour, like you talked about, it's really something that's, you know, touring the country just to speak to people. That's really only reserved for campaigns. Mm-hmm. You know, obviously anybody thinks of the elections we have today, you have candidates, you know, flying around the country and going from little towns to, you know, big cities and arenas and little community centers. Like that's really more of a campaign sort of thing. But President Harding was really someone who just, you know, did it just so he could sort of relate to the people more, in a way that Woodrow Wilson really didn't do that much. But in the summer of 1923, speaking of these train tours, he took a train trip to the West. He was actually the first president to visit Alaska on this trip. Unknown to the public, his health was in pretty dire condition. And on July the 29th, he settled in the Palace Hotel in San Francisco, and he checked into the presidential suite to get some rest, along with his wife as well, by the way. And 4 days later, on August 2nd, his wife Florence read him an article about himself from the Saturday Evening Post that was called A Calm Review of a Calm Man. Talk about sort of how whoever wrote this article perceived him as a calm man. And around 7:30 that evening, Florence paused and Harding told her, quote, "That's good. Go on, read some more." She continued to read when only a few seconds later, the president twisted violently in the bed asking for air. And Mrs. Harding called the doctors into the room to try and save him, but it was of no use. And Warren G. Harding was dead at the age of 57. So this kind of came just out of nowhere, at least in the eyes of the country. We'll get into just a second the controversies and everything. But at the time, the public was absolutely devastated that their leader, who was so well liked, was just, seemed like out of nowhere he was gone.
Mm-hmm. It was really kind of shocking to everyone. It was an unexpected death. He was someone who, in a lot of ways, was at the height of a lot of his popularity. And, the nation took it hard. You know, this is the first president to die since, William McKinley, and so much has happened. You know, the nation has really modernized in a lot of ways. And it felt raw to a lot of people, because in the way that he kind of toured the nation and seemed very relatable to the common man, people took it more personally because they felt like they could relate to him, if that makes sense. He was their president. And, when he died, a lot of people felt as if they'd kind of lost a friend in Washington, D.C.
Right. Right. And that was the public reception of it. Again, I'll reiterate what I said earlier. When, the last point he was in office before he passed, he was one of the most popular presidents in history, at least while he was in office. And so again, the country mourned their leader. But again, this grief period would be very short-lived, because less than a year after his death, a number of scandals came out that forever crushed Harding's image. Mm-hmm. One of these involved Harding's Secretary of the Interior, a man named Albert Fall, who was accused of improperly leasing Navy oil reserves at Elk Hills, California, and Teapot Dome in Wyoming to two wealthy oil men in exchange for an illegal kickback. And this became known as Teapot Dome, which would, up until Watergate, become the most well-known presidential scandal. Like, we know Watergate mm-hmm. today. Everybody names this Gates, that Gates. Like, that was really what Teapot Dome was. Mm-hmm. It was just a huge presidential scandal. And, Harding's... he didn't have a direct relation to Teapot Dome, in terms of he didn't actually sort of set the events into motion himself intentionally. But his problem was he hired dishonest, non-qualified men to very, very important positions. Mm-hmm. And that was really detrimental to his success as president, and his complicity made the scandals all the more worse.
And in a way that, really affected his image too. There was kind of a general perception, and there is some evidence pointing to that he was kind of aware of these things and knew that these people were not who he should be, appointing to these positions, but he did it anyway, either because it was kind of politically convenient for him, or in a lot of cases because they were his friends. And if, they were going to illegally make some money on the side, who was he to stop them? That certainly does not help any president when a scandal comes out within their administration that they, had at least some awareness of it and chose not to do anything. And, even though it's fair to say that Wilson wasn't, like, at least in these scandals, the governmental scandals, was not personally involved in them, he was aware of what was going on and did not intervene to stop them.
No, it wasn't. And I mentioned earlier when we started talking about Harding, he was a frequent gambler. I believe I read that he gambled away an entire set of china, which mm-hmm. had been under Benjamin Harrison's administration. So, White House china, Sia, and I don't know what he got in return. I don't know what got into his head that he's thinking, let's just gamble away some White House china. But hey, that's the way President Harding thought. But even more stunning to the public was the next big scandal that rolled in, which was the allegation that Harding's wife Florence had poisoned him. This is one that's never really been 100% confirmed. From what I've read, it doesn't look like it has a ton of merit. But it's because the sort of assumption of this happened because after his death, Florence did not allow an autopsy of her body, which is a little shady. But the final scandal that just absolutely just destroyed his image came into fruition from Nan Britton, who was a woman who claimed that she had been Harding's lover and that she had shared her daughter Elizabeth with the president. And although for nearly a century it was anybody's guess as to whether it was whether she had or not, a 2015 study from Ancestry.com through DNA testing found out that yes, Elizabeth was Harding's child. And so this just crushed his image. And you know, unlike Wilson, I talked about, he's sort of inconsistently ranked on a lot of lists. Harding is almost always at the bottom in one of the five worst presidents that we've ever had. So just the domino effect of these scandals, one after the other, talk about how his image just absolutely plummeted.
Yeah, it was kind of, he went from being this kind of relatable, popular figure that kind of understood the American people to this kind of like amoral, you know, liar that wasn't really anyone that the American people wanted to associate themselves with. So it was kind of like this very, very dramatic shift in the way people saw him. And, you know, it really did tank his legacy. He's to some extent kind of forgotten today. And, you know, you would probably be hard pressed to find like a really strong Warren Harding fan out there. And he kind of, and I think the part of it is because it's this mix of governmental and then also personal scandal. And I feel like it just really kind of hits him from both sides and just makes him so much less likable of a figure because he's having this very popular message and he wants to be viewed as kind of this popular figure around the nation. And yet he also is doing things that just are kind of scummy, especially his affairs. And there is, did you mention the Carrie Phillips affair?
I did not mention that. I actually was not aware of that. If you would like to
so
share.
He had another affair that probably lasted for over a decade. So the letters of this affair were found after his death. And there was a lawsuit. They were found in the early 60s, a lawsuit involving his relatives about whether they should be public or not. They were given to the Library of Congress, and they were sealed as a result of that lawsuit until 2014. And the letters are public, but I would warn anyone who wants to go check them out. They're very explicit. You know, he and Carrie are writing back and forth, and they are very intimate letters, and they are very explicit letters. And you know, it makes you feel for Harding's wife. You know, you have these two separate affairs. You have affairs that are like pretty deeply personal, and you know, this whole time, it's just kind of, he's putting up this kind of public front and it just makes him unlikable. He's not someone you want to root for once you get kind of a complete picture of who he is.
Not at all. Now that you brought, I didn't know the name, but now you brought up like sort of the details behind it. I think I actually have seen some of those and not just read the letters, but if it's the same woman you're referring to, yes, they had quite the affair. There's no question about it. But again, his personal life was kind of a mess. Actually, there's no kind of, it was a mess. And then, like you said, the governmental scandals, Teapot Dome, and he's kind of a perfect example. We've seen other presidents who've had sort of the same thing, like not just the policies, but like the things that he did get done in a short time in office were actually not bad, but it's the personal, it's the behind the scenes stuff. Once people kind of found out who he really was, like you said, it was just, people were done with him. And matter of fact, I believe that once his wife actually passed the year after he passed, after I believe they created like the Harding tomb or something like that. They built the Harding tomb, and future president, we'll discuss him, Herbert Hoover, like dedicated to his former boss because he did work in the Harding administration. It was not well received at all by the public, because once everybody got word of this, they pretty much turned a cold shoulder to that of Warren G. Harding. So certainly a pretty bad legacy. There's no question about it. And so now let's move on to successors. So President Harding dies. And after the news had spread of the president's passing, because remember, this was he passed a little after 7:30 Pacific time. So on the East Coast, it's, you know, everybody's in bed by the time this happens. So a lot of people are just waking up to the news. And it made its way to Vice President Calvin Coolidge. He was awakened at his father's house in Vermont in the middle of the night to be informed of the death in San Francisco. And Coolidge got dressed, said a prayer, made his way downstairs where a number of reporters were gathered in the dark room lit by a kerosene lamp. And Coolidge's father was actually a justice of the peace and ministered the oath over the family Bible, where his son Calvin became the nation's 30th president. And, you know, as we'll get into Calvin's personality in just a second, but this is kind of a perfect example of that. After suddenly becoming the leader of the free world, just out of nowhere, and he assumes this incredible power, Calvin Coolidge went right back to bed. So he was a very, very relaxed individual. So before we even you know get into him, let's give him a proper introduction.
Number 30, Calvin Coolidge, Republican, 1923 to 1929, 51 years old. From Massachusetts.
So Calvin Coolidge, Silent Cal as he became known, we're going to tell a story, a good story about that, but he was born on July 4th of 1892. He's the only president to be born on Independence Day to, as I mentioned, John Calvin Coolidge Sr. and Victoria Josephine Moore. And he married Grace Goodhue in 1905. They had two children together. And again, he was a very laid back, relaxed, like, you know, Harding, as we mentioned, he was obviously, we know about the scandals later on, but before that even came out, they had this perception of him, the public did, of this big personality, someone you want to kind of wrap your arms around. Not the case with Calvin Coolidge. He's kind of quiet, reserved, laid back. Just talk about him as an individual.
You know, he was just a very introverted, very quiet man. He was known to have like a pretty good sense of humor, but he was just very introverted. He was quiet. There was a reason why he had the nickname Silent Cal, and it was because he was quite literally silent. He didn't talk much. And I feel like, you know, I wish there was more to say, but that really is kind of the extent of it. He was really quiet. Now, his wife, Grace, on the other hand, was very social, was very popular in D.C., was very lively, very much the life of the party. And sometimes that could clash because he was, again, quiet, did not communicate very well, and that could cause some problems. Like, you know, when he announced eventually that he was not going to run for a second full term, but like a third term in office, he didn't tell her beforehand. She found out after he announced it. And when they asked her about it, she was like, I guess he's not running again. Like, I don't know. And, you know, which calls into some question about how healthy their marriage was at times. But, you know, it seemed to be fairly loving. But, you know, it's notable to say that he was pretty consistent in his, you know, introverted tendencies. He just was not a talker.
No. And a great story about this. Again, you're more well up on this stuff than I am, so correct me if this story is incorrect. But the story goes about his sort of dry wit humor, again, silence. Again, he became known as Silent Cal. Mm-hmm. He was at a steak dinner one time, and there was a woman sitting next to him who said, quote, Mr. President, I bet I can get you to say more than two words over the course of this evening. Coolidge turned to her and replied, quote, you lose. So that was all he had to say. And yes. You know, that's kind of how he was. And but in terms of policy, he was very much like, now in terms of communication, not even close to the guy I'm about to mention, but he was very much like Ronald Reagan. He was a staunch supporter of limited government. That was really where he based all of his policy on. And But again, 1924 comes around. He's barely a year into his presidency, and the American public voted to keep cool with Coolidge and giving him a full term of his own. And actually, at his inauguration, the presidential oath was administered by Chief Justice William Howard Taft, which is the first time ever an ex-president has administered the oath to a president. So we talked about at the end of episode five about how Taft sort of came into his the job he really wanted, which was being a justice of the Supreme Court. He later became Chief Justice. And if I'm not mistaken, Isaac, I believe he also administered the oath to Herbert Hoover later on. Am I correct?
I believe so.
So that's a really cool fact in presidential history. But Coolidge kept a tight rein on the federal budget. He used his veto power to kill pay raises for postal workers, and he also lowered taxes twice. And his main goal, again, was to keep the government small while also making business big. His economic policies were very successful for the time being, you know, considering that it was called the Roaring Twenties. And, you know, they failed to kind of, the only downside is they failed to anticipate the Great Depression, which was to come at the end of the decade. So just talk about sort of the policies he put in place and the sort of not just, I wouldn't even say he's your typical traditional conservative like a Harding or like a Taft. Like he's very, why he's silent, he's very strong in these beliefs and keeping the government small.
No, he very much is. He was a very smart man. And, you know, he was very dedicated to the job of being president. You know, there's a story about him. You know, he would go through the budgets with his staff and would look for anything. And I mean, literally anything that they could possibly cut out to make the budget smaller, even to the extent that he would make them use pencils until literally all of the pencil was gone, until the very last little bit had been shaved away and they could not use the pencil anymore, and that they were not allowed to get new pencils until the pencils were quite literally completely used up. Which sounds unreasonable to almost anyone that hears that, but he was, you know, very adamant that, you know, if the government is going to tax people for money to buy these pencils, then, you know, we should not be wasting that money. We need to kind of conserve it and use as little of it as possible. And, you know, I think the pencil example is one of the best ones to kind of show kind of the extremes and the lengths he was willing to go to. But it wasn't just because he was like OCD or crazy or anything like that. It was just because he was, you know, very ideological, and he felt that it was kind of morally wrong for him and for the government to use money that had been taken from the people through taxes to kind of waste it. And he viewed kind of anything that was not necessary as being a waste. And, you know, I think that that's one of the most important facets of his presidency, is just the way that he really did work to shrink the size of the government, which is interesting because this is in the progressive era. You know, this is the Roaring Twenties. This is still very much the progressive era in the United States. But, you know, he was this very strong advocate for limited government and ran a very limited presidential administration. And, you know, just within his role as president, he kind of had the policy that, you know, he wouldn't, it wasn't his job to make these policies. It was Congress's job, and that he would react to the policies they put forth to him, which if a president said that now, people would literally think they were crazy. Would be like, what are you talking about? That is not how the president's supposed to work. But that was his understanding of it based off of the Constitution. And, you know, he basically said, I'm going to follow, you know, the example that I think is right. And is the way that I'm, you know, kind of cut out to do this job. And I think that, in my personal opinion, he did a good job. Again, he didn't anticipate the Great Depression, which is a big blind spot. But, you know, I don't think any president necessarily could have, you know, foreseen the Great Depression, which maybe is me being too lenient with him. Another thing that I think is notable with him is that he gave, you know, the indigenous people, indigenous Americans, U.S. citizenship, which was the first time that had ever happened in the nation's history, and had a meeting with the leaders of several different tribal nations at the White House, and, you know, was very well liked and recognized by the members of that community at the time for really working to kind of help benefit them and uplift their situation. And also I will, because I think it's notable, his vice president, Herbert Hoover's vice president, this is getting a little bit forward, Charles Curtis would be the first non-white vice president of the United States. He was a Native American. So we see, especially in the Coolidge administration, some important movements within the federal government's policy towards Native Americans and kind of giving them more independence to be able to kind of rule over some of their ancestral lands. They don't have control over all of them, but within their reservations, they were given a lot more leniency, and the tribal nations were given a lot more control. And a lot of that is because of Coolidge's advocacy for them.
Yeah, he did do a lot of great things for the indigenous community. I did not know that Herbert Hoover's vice president was himself indigenous. I think that's a very interesting fact. I'm not good at my vice presidential history outside of a few, and then obviously the ones like Coolidge who ended up becoming president. But back to kind of the inability to anticipate the Great Depression, do you think maybe that had something to do with the fact that, like his predecessor Harding, he was very, you know, reliant on his cabinet? Do you think that had anything to do with that?
Possibly. I thought about this question a lot, about kind of how much blame goes on who for the Great Depression. And I think it's just very difficult. I will be an advocate now. I don't think it's Herbert Hoover's fault. He gets a lot of blame. No. I don't think it's fault at all. I don't know if it's fair to blame it on Calvin Coolidge, though. I'm not really sure if it's fair to blame it on any president. I think that, you know, obviously some of his policies and the way that he ran the Federal Reserve at the time, it does play into that. But I don't think that it was enough to kind of be cited as like the cause for the Great Depression, if that makes sense. I think that it maybe didn't help things going forward, because I think that while his policies, I think, you know, worked well for a time when there wasn't, a financial crisis going on, I think that when there is a financial crisis going on, you know, steps had to be taken temporarily to get the country out of that crisis. And I don't know if Coolidge would have done that. So I think that it's a little bit in between. I think that his policies didn't help it, but I think within the context of what he was doing with his policies and the time that he was doing his policies, that they weren't bad or necessarily the cause of it, if that makes sense.
Yeah, no, it does make sense. I see, my view is, I don't think it's Coolidge's, you know, directly from him. I don't think that's, you know, his policies or anything. I don't necessarily think that was the issue. I think, like, sort of as you, like, for example, his Secretary of the Treasury, Andrew Miller, was the third richest man in America. And so no economic collapse was going to touch him, right? So maybe it was, maybe some of it was the fact that maybe the guys he surrounded himself with, it wouldn't have necessarily been a huge deal among them. Again, I think that's certainly possible. But I think Coolidge's biggest error was trusting guys like Miller. And then the economic crisis to come would just be, you know, an absolute disaster. But no, his policies were fairly successful, as you mentioned. And again, I totally agree with you. I don't think Coolidge himself is directly responsible for the Great Depression. We come around to 1928. He declined, as you said, to run for a second term. And so the Secretary of the Commerce, Herbert Hoover, won the election. And, you know, Coolidge has kind of earned praise in recent years by conservatives for keeping a small government as president. And he's garnered praise in recent years for his ardent support for, like you said, indigenous rights and racial equality as a whole. He was sort of ahead of the times on those beliefs, to his credit. But, you know, true to form, he had a very quiet retirement. Sadly for him, a fairly brief retirement. He actually passed on January the 5th of 1933 at the age of 60. His final words were spoken to a carpenter working on his house. He said, "Good morning, Robert." And those were the final words he spoke. So, again, he was just sort of like fade off the distance. Like, he's sort of like President Harding for obviously different reasons than Harding, but not a well or not a, not he's not well liked, but he's not a widely discussed. Well-remembered, yes. Well-remembered, widely discussed president. But sort of talk about his legacy and where it sort of fits in presidential history, at least for this time, coming into what is going to be a pivotal point in our history.
Well, I think for one thing that I do want to mention, I think that part of it is because I don't think he necessarily wanted to be well-remembered. Not that he didn't, you know, want people to like him, but just that he did not think that the presidency should kind of be some big ornate thing. And he didn't really have an interest in that personally. So like, you know, something interesting that I think kind of some shows his kind of view of how his legacy should be. If you look at his gravestone, most presidents have pretty kind of ornate kind of monuments or memorials to them, even if it is just on their headstone. His headstone has the presidential seal at the top and just says Calvin Coolidge, the date of his birth and the date of his death, nothing more. You know, you could very well look at it and have no idea that he was ever president of the United States or even really the kind of notable in American history, just from the look of it. And I think that, you know, that says something kind of about, I think he was a very humble person. I think that says a lot about how he viewed the presidency and kind of how he viewed himself. And I think going forward, you know, I think we're going to see that he will eventually kind of be invoked by Ronald Reagan, most notably, as kind of a symbol for what the Republican Party should kind of harken back to and what they should be. And I think, you know, that trend has kind of continued, that he is becoming more and more kind of a symbol of conservatism in a way that he was not immediately following his death, partially because of the Great Depression. So I think that if anything, you know, his legacy nowadays is kind of starting to be restored. But I think that also, you know, immediately at the time, the way that he's going to affect, I don't think that he really affects the contemporary time that much. Like, I think, like, going forward in the political era, I think the election of Hoover is very much because of the popularity of Coolidge and the way that that kind of rubs off on Herbert Hoover. But, you know, after that, it all kind of falls apart with the Great Depression. And I think that that political era with Coolidge and Hoover is just kind of over, and we enter into kind of a brand new Republican era when we get to Eisenhower.
Right. No, I absolutely agree with you. I think it's the case that we see with a lot of presidents and you know, members of their cabinet winning office after they step away. Sort of if they endorse what the outgoing president's successful policies were, then, you know, we assume that they're just going to continue those. So I think that's one Herbert Hoover, the White House, and it's safe to say he was very, very much maligned, Herbert Hoover.
Number 31, Herbert Hoover, Republican, 1929 to 1933, 54 years old, from California.
First president from the state of California, Herbert Hoover was born on August the 10th of 1874 to Jesse Hoover and Huldah Minthorn. Tragically, both parents died by the time Herbert was 10, leaving he and his siblings as orphans. And he married Lou Henry in 1899. They had two children together. Again, not just the first president born in California, he was the first president born west of the Mississippi. Mm. And as a kid, he had sometimes, certainly you would assume due to the deaths of his parents at an early age, he kind of had a tendency towards melancholy. And after graduating from Stanford, he built a successful mining company that made him a millionaire, which, you know, like presidents, his favorite pastime was fishing. Well, I'll get into the Hoover Ball thing in just a second, but just he's kind of got a really inspiring, like, kind of rags to riches story of somebody who had it rough as a kid, but, you know, made something of himself. So talk about I know I ask you this question about every president, but really the public's perception of Hoover pre Great Depression, how it got him elected into the White House.
Herbert Hoover was really, really popular, you know, pre-presidency, pre-Great Depression, really. He was a great humanitarian. He was someone, like you said, that had a rags-to-riches story, and he gave away so much of his wealth. He helped rebuild Europe after World War One. He did a lot of work just on the ground to try to help end things like starvation, child labor. He was an advocate for people who really were kind of voiceless in society. And, I think Hoover is someone, and you'll see this theme and how I talked about him during this. He gets, I think, too much hate. He really was, while I will agree with the historians, he was not a good president. He did not do a great job. He did not handle the crisis well, but he was one of the best men to have ever held the office. He was like genuinely a good person. And I think that, that was definitely the way he was viewed, before the Depression hit. He was just kind of viewed as this kind of like hero, I think is a fair word to call him. He was just viewed as someone who kind of genuinely cared about people and wasn't just a politician, but was kind of a friend to the American people.
Right. And that's, again, his popularity, I don't think it's just his popularity, like people liked him. I think people actually respected him because of those humanitarian works that you mentioned in detail, sort of his upfront, honest persona. But before we get into any of the policies, I want to go back to, he did love to fish. That was, many presidents. Calvin Coolidge was an avid fisherman, but as was Herbert Hoover. But his doctor told him that he needed to get more exercise, and so he created his own game called Hoover Ball. And it was kind of this game where, I'm a sports guy, but I'm not even going to try to explain the rules of Hoover Ball because they're too complex. But basically, the President Hoover and members of Congress and the cabinet and other people would sort of get together, play the game, get a good exercise, and sort of, as they're playing before and after, like discuss ideas. And so it was a good way for, both sides, Democrats, Republicans, to kind of sort of come to know each other on a more personal level, like see each other, not just as the guy from the opposite party, but hey, he's someone who wants the good of the, wants the best for America, just like I do. So it was actually a fairly successful mechanism in doing so, but the Hoover Ball thing's always gotten kind of a kick out of that. But he's also the first president, by the way, to have a telephone installed in the Oval Office and the first to hire an executive staff. And again, he was seen as sort of very much like Calvin Coolidge, a big business Republican who could relate to the common man, but obviously because of his wealth. And again, like you say, he's a good dude. He was, doing all these humanitarian efforts. But, from the public's perception, they felt like maybe they couldn't relate to him as much. Right. Maybe because of he wore the collar, up real tight around his neck and, obviously his wealth. Some in the country, came to resent him for that. But he certainly had a level of sympathy toward the common man, as you mentioned. He was one of the first successfully international capitalists. But he had a quote. He said, the only problem with capitalism is our capitalists. They're just too greedy. So he sort of had an issue with those who are at the top, who were kicking the little guy down. Like he was very much a believer in capitalism, but he had an issue just with the people on top who were doing the things to those who genuinely were in need. So I think he does at least deserve a little bit of credit for that. But he was also one you'd probably call a workaholic. He managed the country kind of like a CEO would. But we go into the fall of 1929, and as Isaac and I have pointed out, the economy absolutely tanks. The stock market crash of 1929 and the Great Depression had started. And of course, like you mentioned, and this is often a common misconception among people who talk about presidents. Herbert Hoover himself did not cause the Depression. Actions he took his first, again, he's not even a year into office. They didn't cause the Depression. That's why some people today sometimes associate more blame with Coolidge than they do with Hoover, because Hoover just comes in and the Depression comes, that fall. Like he's like, oh crap, I'm just in this tough position. So talk about how that all went down and how obviously Hoover's popularity just plummeted almost immediately.
So when the Depression starts on Black Tuesday, you know, Hoover's kind of first instinct is to kind of try to downplay the crisis and to get business leaders on the same page to kind of stop them from making any, like, rash decisions that could kind of lead to a worsening of the crisis. So basically, he meets with them and he kind of puts on, like, this, like, optimistic public face to be like, things are going to be okay. Like, we're going to move out of this, just like give it a little bit of time. And, you know, he genuinely thinks at that period of time too, that this is going to be a momentary problem, that this might last like a year and then we'll kind of come out of it and things will be fine. In the way that other, you know, economic depressions had happened in the US history. But obviously that's not what happened with the Great Depression. It lingered and it got worse. And some of it was because of his inaction. You know, he wasn't willing and didn't really believe in policies that were going to have government intervention in the market to try to alleviate the crisis and to try to get the economy back on track, which is really the only governmental option you have in trying to alleviate a financial crisis. You know, he was someone who, you know, even like most Republicans today, don't believe in those policies. But unlike today, there are Republicans now that would say, you know, we can do these policies when there is a crisis and then end them as soon as that crisis has kind of been alleviated, just like a temporary measure, kind of like, maybe this isn't a good example, but kind of like social distancing and mask wearing, where we'll have them while we have the pandemic, and then once the pandemic is gone, we won't have them anymore. Just kind of a general concept like that. Like, it's a temporary measure to try to kind of alleviate a problem. And, you know, that's very much something that he just didn't believe in, just ideologically wise. It was something that hadn't been done before. And, you know, he just wasn't comfortable with setting that precedent, especially if he wasn't sure if it was going to work. And because of that, you know, the depression just lingered and got worse, and it began to affect more and more people. And, you know, he also signed the Smoot-Hawley Tariff Act into law, which, you know, ultimately restricted international trade, which actually made the economy worse, even though the expectation is that it would lead to kind of a boom in industry within the U.S. Instead, it just resulted in less things being brought into the country to be sold, and that just hurt the economy even further. So, you know, there's a couple missteps there. There's kind of like, you know, he has too much of kind of an optimistic idea of what's going to happen going into it. And it just doesn't, things just don't line up. So it's not that he doesn't try to do anything, because he does try to do things, especially, you know, at the beginning, but it just doesn't work. And, you know, as his administration goes on, he just, you know, he tries, you know, messing with taxes to try to alleviate things. And then the government winds up having to raise taxes, and it just doesn't work. And, you know, a lot of that falls on his shoulders as the president of the United States, you know, because so many people are suffering under this time. And you see, you know, things like Hoovervilles come up and people are blaming him for this crisis, especially, you know, because you think this is coming straight out of, you know, the success and the economic prosperity of the Roaring Twenties. And you go into just this complete and total, you know, just loss of all of that momentum and movement. And, you know, he is kind of powerless to stop it. And, you know, the longer the depression lingers, the less and less people like him.
Right. And, you know, you brought it up briefly, like his sort of, at least his initial solution for the problem was what was called voluntarism. Mm-hmm. And basically it asked corporations if they would improve wages and working conditions. And like you said, I think you make a good point. Like, you know, obviously, you know, we talk about Republicans, and again, we're moving into this more modern era of more, you know, conservative, big business Republicans. That's fine. If that's your belief that, you know, booming business and small government, you know, that's fine. His issue was, as you brought up, is, and maybe you could say it's what kind of got him elected, but at the same time, you can't just completely shun the government. It's got to do something. If you're somebody who thinks it's, you know, needs to be pushed to the back, fine. But eventually it's got to become somewhat of a factor. And that's really where the public kind of turned on him, is it made it appear, maybe this wasn't, it probably wasn't Hoover's intention, but it made it appear was, you know, you're not going to expend all the resources necessary to help us. You really don't care about us. Mm-hmm. That was sort of the mentality from those who had been suffering in the Great Depression. And again, his re-election bid in 1932 was probably one of the most miserable re-election bids in any running for re-election. His name basically became a synonym for presidential failure. And you brought up Hooverville. They nicknamed all these things. So, for example, a Hoover hotel was a cardboard shack. Hooverville was a group of cardboard shacks. A Hoover flag was an empty pocket turned inside out. And again, inside, this just absolutely crushed him. And, you know, again, the campaign trail was just horrible. And protesters would be present, and they would chant things such as, "We want bread, we want bread." And again, he absolutely had no chance whatsoever to win re-election. And really sort of the final nail in his presidential coffin was that in June of that same year, 1932, desperate World War I veterans went to Washington to demand early pay of bonuses that weren't due to be paid until 1945. And after the protesters had occupied most of the buildings in Washington, Hoover enlisted the help of General Douglas MacArthur to clear them out. And MacArthur sort of went beyond his duty. Not only did he clear them out or evacuate them from the buildings, but he moved them all the way to the Anacostian Flats, where there was an encampment of these marchers. And MacArthur and his army burned these encampments to the ground. And so Hoover didn't order him to do this, but he went beyond this. And, you know, the man he was running against, from New York, Franklin D. Roosevelt, he heard of the news and he told an advisor, quote, "This elects me." Now, I don't know if that elected him, but it pretty much made it official. There was no chance, you know, whatsoever that Herbert Hoover was going to win re-election. Mm. And Roosevelt won the
land. And it is important to note that Hoover did not order the brutality that was taken, but after MacArthur did that, he did kind of put between a rock and a hard place. He did defend the decision, which I think in a lot of ways put the nail in the coffin. If he had come out against it, he would have looked like a liar and a hypocrite. And if he defended it like he did, then, it just, people did not support that and were not going to get behind what happened there.
And also something else was, obviously, he won in 1928 because of his sort of sympathy for the common man. But his biggest issue was he was a terrible communicator. His speeches were not in any way inspiring. Mm-hmm. They were dry, didn't, you know, have any energy, which was the opposite of Franklin D. Roosevelt, which we'll get into obviously in a second. But he left office and it has continued to this day, one of the least popular presidents in history. The good news for him was he actually had the longest presidential retirement in history at over 31 years. And some good things actually happened for him during his retirement. I wasn't able to get it in my notes. I wasn't able to fit it in. Is there anything that you have to add to that equation?
I think there's one other thing that I just want to note about Hoover, which is just his post-presidency kind of in general. Yeah. I think it's important to mention about him. You know, he lived until the 1960s, so he had a long post-presidency. He continued the humanitarian work he did earlier in life throughout the rest of his post-presidency. He gave away a lot of his personal money to try to help people who, for decades later, were still recovering from the Great Depression, something that he personally felt very guilty for, especially later in life. And then he also was in charge of and helped with the recovery of Europe once again after World War II. And, I think that his legacy, I think that, you know, even he would not want to be remembered for his presidency, but I think most certainly he should be remembered for his contributions just as a humanitarian to helping rebuild Europe after both world wars and kind of being an advocate for those for kind of the impoverished people around the world, even though, you know, in his presidency he seems like the least sympathetic person to that cause. I think out of all the presidents, he's one of the few that I think really, really, without a doubt, you can say, understood what these people were going through and felt for them and wanted to help them. And, you know, obviously that didn't play out the way he wanted it to as president, but, you know, in his personal life, I think it would be hard to find a president who was as great of an advocate just for kind of the common man as he was.
Yeah, absolutely. And that often shows sort of the difference we see with there have been presidents who, you know, thought maybe the government shouldn't be getting in all this business, but genuinely, personally, they really did feel for these people. And in their, you know, in their personal lives, they did do what they could to help them. But again, Hoover's big mistake was not going all the way in terms of, you know, if the government's the last resort, in his mind, you know, we got to at least exercise that resort to at least attempt to help these people. And that was ultimately where his presidential demise really happened. But again, like you said, you know, fortunately for him, he did have a very long retirement, 31 years. And he died on October 20th of 1964 at the age of 90. And so certainly one of the more maligned presidents in history. So we transition oftentimes we go from, as far as the public perception, at least today, of presidents, usually we end up going from a highly criticized, hated president to a very well beloved president to this day, although this guy's legacy has changed in some ways, which we'll get into. But one of the more, without a shadow of a doubt, one of the more iconic presidencies, Franklin D. Roosevelt.
Number 32, Franklin D. Roosevelt. Democrat, 1933 to 1945, 51 years old, from New York.
Many of the things in FDR's sort of the things that happened in his personal life did not seem to exactly guarantee him, you know, presidential immortality in some ways. But he was born on January the 30th of 1882 to James Roosevelt and Sarah Delano. He married Eleanor Roosevelt in 1905, and they had six children together. And of course, as you might assume by the last name, he was related to Theodore Roosevelt. He was the fifth cousin of him. And he was not a dumb guy, but he was a C student at Harvard. His daughter Anna, he once said that he was sort of difficult to know, like you couldn't really know him, like in his personal life, that, you know, no one really knew the man. But, you know, in the public eye, vastly different story. He was, you know, very charming, very charismatic, and the people sort of drew to that, in contrast of the sort of, not, I wouldn't say aloof about Herbert Hoover, but, you know, kind of dry personality that he had. So talk about FDR and his, obviously we'll get into his disability in just a second, but like how the public just absolutely just fell in love with him.
Yeah. He, you know, had been a vice presidential candidate, earlier in his career, and did not become vice president. And, you know, during, you know, Hoover's time as president, he kind of comes out as a popular figure within the Democratic Party as kind of advocating against Hoover's Great Depression policies, and is kind of invoking this kind of broad vision for reform and this progressive agenda that, you know, we last saw with Woodrow Wilson. And he really is kind of championing kind of this major shift in American government and society. And it's a message that is, you know, really kind of inspiring to the American people, especially at that time when they really needed hope. And it was just a message that Hoover didn't have. So as he kind of rises on the scene, he's viewed as this person who is just, you know, kind of hearkening back to the past when Wilson was president, to when times were better just for the American people generally. So you have some like nostalgia there. Then you also have this message that is very much like, you know, this is the future. These are new things that haven't been done before, and we're going to do them. And, you know, that message is, you know, successful. He wins the election. And he comes back to that pretty continuously throughout his presidency. Obviously, you know, during the war, his messaging shifts, but his kind of harkening back to kind of, you know, Wilson and even other, you know, kind of historical figures in America's past, and kind of using them and kind of claiming to be the torchbearer of what they really meant, kind of this American system to be, to kind of push his progressive agenda. And I think that that's something that he did really well. And I think that, you know, as you said, he was a very, very charismatic public figure. And, you know, that I kind of think all paired together with the right message, with the right person, he was able to, you know, drastically transform the federal government. Things kind of lined up through the crisis of the Depression and the crisis of the war to be able to do a lot of what he wanted to do.
Oh, no question. And, you know, I read that Prime Minister Winston Churchill once compared meeting him to opening your first bottle of champagne. So he was very, like, not big personality in the way his fifth cousin was, but very warm and somebody that the public could be drawn to. And as most people know, he was paralyzed by polio at the age of 39 and was mostly confined to a wheelchair for the rest of his life. And all throughout this his campaign in 1932 and throughout his presidency, his condition was completely downplayed by aides and by the media. He would prefer to be photographed standing, despite the fact that he would have to use braces or he'd have to be leaning on the arm of one of his aides. He also had a customized Ford that had hand controls. And so, you know, the media would sort of put out this these videos of him like driving around looking like an able-bodied president. But what they wouldn't show was that he would have to be physically lifted out of the car. And so this was, you know, again, completely by choice, and something I think they wanted to do in order to show that, yes, he obviously had a disability. The public knew that, but also that, hey, he's still a strong guy. He's still, you know, getting along just fine. So just talk about his condition and how that, you know, plays into the media and the public perception of FDR.
Yeah, I think that there are like a number of important things to note about that. You know, one is that kind of his view on his disability was based very much on kind of the cultural view of people who had disabilities at that time. Even though they're, you know, it was from polio, it was viewed, you know, him getting polio as an adult was kind of viewed as a shameful thing, especially because he had, you know, lasting effects from it. That was culturally not something that people were very accepting of. So that's one thing that plays into it. And then another thing is just that, you know, he felt that on the world stage, especially during the war, he would not be taken seriously by other world leaders, that he would be viewed as weak and kind of inferior to them. And, you know, I think that there are, you know, you could read into a lot of that and kind of why he had a view that his disability needed to be kind of kept quiet. And, you know, we also see between then and today, kind of some of the ways that our society has kind of changed its perception of people with disabilities. You know, I think the other thing that is really notable with it is, and he does have a theme of this in his presidency, as do most wartime presidents, Wilson also had a theme of doing this during World War One. Was not a fan of the media. If he was photographed with his braces on or in a wheelchair, most of the time the cameras would be confiscated from the reporters and they would be destroyed. Obviously, we have some videos and photographs of this, but you know, for the most part, they were very, very careful, especially during the war, of trying to make sure that, you know, kind of the propaganda of him, you know, being able-bodied and being able to walk was getting out there, because that is the image that he wanted to kind of promote, not just to Americans, but also to people around the world. And he felt that it was very, very important that that be the way that he was viewed. I think that the media censorship there is notable as well. So,
yeah. Yeah. I mean, I think that, you know, in his case, obviously my personal opinion, look, I guess it's easy for us to say that and say this in 2022. I think it is sad that his physical disability, could be viewed by some, if not many, as something that would hurt him as president, and hurt his leadership styles, for example. So But yeah, it was something he wanted to keep away. It was something that people want to keep away. And but it was certainly a significant part of how he managed things. But speaking of his management style, it was chaotic, to say the least. He often pitted advisors against each other because he gave everybody the opportunity to essentially vent over whatever frustrations they had. And obviously, you know, this became, you know, somewhat difficult to manage. But, you know, he was certainly a great leader, and I'll talk about his legacy over the radio. But, you know, behind the scenes, it was kind of nuts. Like even his White House desk was very cluttered. It was almost a little bit of, I wouldn't say out of control, but certainly bordering on it. But that was, you know, that was how he figured things should be done. But again, his greatest strength, the one I think he is without a question best known for, was his communicating style. It's what got him elected in 1932, and as we'll, you know, see three times after that. His fireside chats on the radio were estimated to have been listened to by around 60% of Americans. And, you know, he was, again, he had a great voice for radio. It's radio is starting to become the number one way of media, along with newspapers, around the 1930s. And so, real quick, I do want to play just a little excerpt from one of his fireside chats real quick here.
After all, there is an element in the readjustment of our financial system more important than currency, more important than gold, and that is the confidence of the people themselves. Confidence and courage are the essentials of success in carrying out our plan. You people must have faith. You must not be stampeded by rumors or guesses. Let us unite in banishing fear. We have provided the machinery to restore our financial system, and it is up to you to support and make it work. It is your problem, my friend, your problem no less than it is mine. Together, we cannot fail.
I mean, as you see, obviously his, you know, that was what was the people, that's what the people were so drawn to. And because of these, he was increasingly popular. So talk about his incredible communicating skills and how that even in times when the Depression's still wasn't really going away, the people still rallied around him and you know, was proud to call him their president.
He just had a very optimistic and uplifting message, and he was able to convey it in a way that, like, you know, Hoover wasn't able to. He was able to convey it in a way that actually made people feel confident and optimistic and hopeful about what was to come. He also was good at kind of having rallying cries and kind of calling people to kind of join in on a specific cause. And I feel like those were all things, you know, being put on this kind of new kind of popular medium was something that really was felt personally by a lot of Americans. You know, it wasn't a president just kind of saying something in like a newspaper that nobody's going to read or whatever. It was the president saying it kind of on the popular medium. It was on what people were at, it was somewhere where people would actually be able to hear it. And you know, this was at a time where he's one of the first presidents that really is able to largely communicate with the entire nation over kind of a short period of time. He can get this message out across the country without having to wait for newspapers to be able to spread it around, or to have, you know, people literally go out and kind of share this message. He's the first one that really utilizes that ability, and utilizes it during two kind of national crises, and is able to just use that to kind of fire people up to get behind his agenda. And, you know, we'll take every little success and we'll emphasize it as being kind of the biggest thing to have ever happened. And he did it well. And that's, I feel like that's kind of the biggest thing, is that he was good at it. Because there are a lot of presidents, you know, since him and even before him, that have tried to do similar things and just failed. And I think for Roosevelt, I think the reason why it worked was just because he was charismatic and he was good at it. And he was able to run a very tight ship and make sure everyone was kind of on board with his narrative. And that's something that I'm not sure any president since him has really been able to do in the same way.
And I think, certainly from my view, obviously this show being, you know, certainly primarily a sports show, I noticed this in sports, and certainly as someone who, you know, avidly follows politics, I just think it's something that you either got it or you don't. Mm-hmm. Can you connect to people or not? We have seen presidents since then that have been able to do that, and then on the other end of the spectrum who couldn't. But I think you make a great point. No one before or after really did it better than FDR did. And so going now into his presidency, a little fun fact, and then we'll really get into the meat of this. Before he did become president, he actually tapped Frances Perkins as his labor secretary, and she was the first woman to be selected to a presidential cabinet. But during his first 100 days in office, he pushed an unprecedented series of bills which were passed by Congress to battle the Depression, which was the start of his new, quote, New Deal. That was what he was sort of his baby in a way. He championed it. And one key figure in the New Deal was actually none other than his first lady, Eleanor Roosevelt. And due to her husband's disabilities, she would travel across the country, sort of get a sense of what public opinion was, a lot of it in the way that Edith Wilson did. But, you know, kind of promoting these pieces of legislation and reporting back to her husband on what the country thought about them. And so, you know, I just think that for Eleanor Roosevelt, she was just an excellent figure in being able to get the message around the country. So just talk about sort of her impact on getting these New Deal bills passed and getting public opinion to kind of rally around them.
You know, Eleanor Roosevelt was, you know, a shrewd politician in her own right. She was someone who was incredibly smart, and she, you know, went on to really have her own political career, especially after her husband's death. But she kind of became, in a lot of ways, a popular advocate for his agenda. And I think the way that she did that was by kind of using the power of being First Lady and kind of being neutral and outside of the political fray to be able to go around and advocate for his policies in a way that wasn't always necessarily political, if that makes sense. She could go around and kind of make these popular appeals to kind of your common everyday Americans without having to go through normal traditional political channels. And by doing that, by kind of being able to bring this message more straight to the people and in a way that was kind of non-traditional and was more relaxed, Eleanor Roosevelt was able to kind of make that message, I really think, just a personal one. It was one that she was able to relay with a lot of kind of sympathy and kind of her own brand of optimism. She was a very good public speaker and was very charismatic, but in a way that was very different from her husband's kind of way of speaking. You know, he kind of had a forceful and kind of a drive to his speech, while she was a little bit softer and just had, I don't know, there's a hopefulness in her voice that is almost always present. And I think that it's something that a lot of people really related to. And I think that it's, just her political skills in their own right, but also I think communication is key so often, is one of the reasons why she's become such figure for kind of women in politics within the United States, and why her memory lives on in the way that it has.
Absolutely. And for that reason, she is one of the more iconic first ladies. And you know, that was, you know, that was what really got, like you said, the different way of communicating with the common man, the common woman, is being able to do this through her great political skills. Mm-hmm. And yes, she very much did have a successful career, after her time as first lady. But, in 1935, one of the, big acts that did get passed was the Social Security Act, which was passed by Congress, which gave help to the elderly, unemployed, and disabled. But again, despite this and all the other, you know, things that were getting passed by Congress, efforts of the New Deal, FDR was to this point not that much more successful than Herbert Hoover in ending the Great Depression. But again, it goes back to his optimistic view of things, getting the people to sort of look at it and say, yes, it's hard today. Yes, you know, things, you know, suck right now, but it's going to be better tomorrow. Like that was what people loved about him. And, you know, because of this, he won re-election in 1936 in what was actually the fourth biggest landslide in American history. Mm-hmm. And in his second term, he sort of, you know, he worried that the conservative-led Supreme Court would nullify the legislation that he had pushed and eventually got passed in his first term. And so he developed the idea to increase the number of justices, or as the term has become known today, pack the court. And, you know, this made to other politicians and to the public, this made Roosevelt appear somewhat kind of power hungry and trying to going out of bounds in terms of dealing with the social problems of the day. And when it was all said and done, his attempt to pack the court ended up failing. So just talk about that whole fiasco and how, you know, it didn't exactly cast the greatest light on FDR.
Yeah, I think that, you know, his attempt to pack the court is probably the best example. One, there are others, of kind of how Roosevelt did not have the greatest concern about the constitutional order. You know, he believed in a very strong executive. He very much viewed himself as the head and kind of the only figurehead of American government. And, you know, he wanted to be able to control large parts of the government kind of without other people trying to meddle in his business. And a lot of this had to do with him wanting to kind of enforce his own kind of vision and agenda for the country. So I don't think that it was all necessarily coming from a bad place. But, you know, to get his kind of vision implemented, he was willing to break major constitutional norms so long as, you know, his agenda was completed. And I think packing the court is probably the best example of that. He did not care if it permanently damaged the Supreme Court. What he cared about was getting, you know, his policies implemented at the end of the day. And I think in some ways there's something admirable about believing in something that strongly, but, you know, when you have a leader like that, it's incredibly dangerous. And I think that sometimes having a wartime leader that is willing to be a little bit loose with their interpretation of the Constitution has been a benefit to America. Abraham Lincoln had to do it.
Yes, he did.
FDR had to do it. Woodrow Wilson had to do it. It's not the first time that happened. But, you know, it is a very, very dangerous thing to do. And every time that it happens, there always is the question of, after the war, can we kind of snap out of it? And I think Roosevelt. I'm getting all the names mixed up today.
Listen, it's a lot going on, man. It's a lot.
But Roosevelt, I think, is probably the one that pushed it farther than any other president has. And I question, you know, he was elected a total of four times to the presidency. If he had lived through his fourth term, I genuinely think he would have run for a fifth. I don't think he ever would have stopped running. And I think that, and I think that he would have continued, even after the war had ended, to kind of push those kind of constitutional limits on his power. And I think that, you know, that is incredibly dangerous to have, especially in the leader of the executive. But I think that, you know, he also was held back by even some of his own Supreme Court nominees. Some of those justices, you know, pushed back on him. And, you know, his court packing attempts ultimately failed. So those kind of checks and balances did hold him back from some of his, you know, even dangerous extremes.
Yeah, and look, whether you have a strict or a loose view of the Constitution, one thing's for certain, the Constitution can't be irrelevant. And so, look, I agree with you. I do think the attempts to do this, I don't think they were coming from necessarily a bad place of heart. I think genuinely he wanted to do what was best for the American people, certainly in such a crisis like the Depression. But the means he went to try and do it were not the best ways to go. But, you know, kind of in his second term, it sort of appeared like he was losing some of his quote unquote magic touch. But, you know, he spent most of his time battling Congress over New Deal legislation. And, you know, it wasn't really until the Second World War began that the president regained the trust and the power that he had initially enjoyed. But, you know, as early, we're sort of transitioning into the next crisis of FDR's presidency. And that would be, of course, World War II. And as early as 1937, FDR saw war on the horizon. And he worked to sort of convince isolationist Americans that someday they may have to get involved with the war. And so the events leading to the U.S.'s involvement kind of start in the summer of 1940 when France fell to Adolf Hitler and the Nazis, and the Battle of Britain began. And so that same year, FDR broke a precedent set by George Washington and became the first president elected to a third term. So this is all sort of happening at the same time. And throughout 1940 and 1941, he found ways to side with the Allies while at the same time keeping the United States officially neutral. But of course, on a fateful December morning in Hawaii, the days of neutrality came to an end.
Yesterday, December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy. The United States of America was suddenly and deliberately attacked by naval and air forces of the Empire of Japan.
You know, the iconic term, a date which will live in infamy, was initially supposed to be, he wanted to say a date which will live in world history, but he changed it at the last minute. But the attacks on Pearl Harbor officially meant that the U.S. had no choice but to get involved in this great war. And Roosevelt was an extremely involved war president. But talk about sort of this, and again, people, we still have people living in this country who are around when the attacks on Pearl Harbor happened. So talk about the public outcry and just how Roosevelt and everybody in politics just all, you know, just went all into this effort.
At the time, Hawaii was still a U.S. territory, but the idea of any part of the United States actually being attacked in a war was something that, you know, we hadn't seen since, you know, really the Spanish-American War, but even that's a little bit questionable because we didn't have battles on, like, within the continental U.S. It was close, but that was the closest that we had really gotten. So this is kind of the first time for a lot of these people, even though they had experienced war before, brutal wars like World War One. You know, they hadn't experienced the idea of America actually being attacked. And it really genuinely outraged people for a number of reasons. One, you do have, you know, the older generation, the World War One generation, that is, you know, sitting there thinking, like, how did we not learn that this was a bad idea the first time we did it? Like, so there's outrage that, you know, that world war is even happening, that Europe is at war again after, you know, all the sacrifices that people put through in World War One to try to end that conflict and to try to preserve peace afterwards. But then you also have just this outrage at us being attacked in a way that most of the public viewed as being completely unprovoked. And it just resulted in a very quick public shift in whether the U.S. should be involved in the war or not, and especially the war in the Pacific. At that point in time, it was clear we had been attacked by Japan. There wasn't really much of a choice there but to go to war with them. But, you know, after that, and as a result of Pearl Harbor, the U.S. also declared war on Nazi Germany, and it was just became clear to FDR and to other politicians and to the American public at large that, you know, this wasn't the same situation as World War One. We couldn't just continue putting off intervening in the war. We just had to do it. We had to kind of join in now before it was too late, and war continued to spread throughout the world. You know, it's that same kind of rock and hard place that Wilson was kind of put into, which is how long do you wait for it to happen? And, FDR kind of waited until America was really affected by this. And as soon as that happened, he kind of jumped and entered us into the war in a way that, you know, is risky for a president. But I feel like he should be commended. I feel like it was necessary. And if the U.S. had waited any longer to join in the war in Europe, you know, who knows what would have happened.
Right, right. And you know, it's different from our involvement in World War One in that, you know, Woodrow Wilson, you know, sort of pushed for us to get in and got us in it because, you know, we had, you mentioned earlier, Americans were sort of in the crossfire of the war, right? Mm-hmm. Like Americans were being attacked, but not deliberately because they're American. In this case, mm-hmm. the country as a whole, obviously Hawaii, as you mentioned, was still a U.S. territory, but the country as a whole was deliberately, as FDR pointed out, attacked. Mm-hmm. And so we move into the war, and FDR is extremely, involved, and he did an excellent job at picking his generals, starting with George Marshall. However, early into America's involvement in the war, FDR made, in my opinion, the worst decision of his presidency. And that was on February the 19th of 1942. He signed into executive law the internment of over 100,000 Japanese Americans because he didn't believe that they could be trusted. And it was certainly a low point in his administration, something I think that in recent years he's garnered more criticism for. And just talk about that and just sort of his, a rare... not necessarily a rare misstep, but just a rare inability to see that this was not in the slightest bit necessary. Not only that, it was completely and deliberately attacking their civil rights.
Mm-hmm. During the war, within the U.S. and around the world, people of German descent and German immigrants were targeted, and so were Japanese and Asian immigrants at a larger scale were targeted by people with hate crimes and just with pushed outside of everyday society. So I'll touch on the impact of the Germans really shortly. There was nothing like the internment camps, but street names and things that were named after people who were ethnically German, those street names were changed to more quote unquote like American sounding names and things like that, because of the reaction to kind of Germany being like the big bad guy in this war. And not being able to make that distinction between the leaders of Germany and the German people. And for the Japanese, that took, an even larger toll, with them being quite literally put in internment camps. People who were everyday civilians that had not done anything wrong. And a lot of cases were not even Japanese. They were, Korean or Chinese or some other kind of Southeast Asian ethnicity, and they were kind of wrapped up in this and put in these internment camps without any trial, without any time to pack up their belongings, to kind of take care of their affairs at home. They were taken away, and their only option to leave the camps was to enlist in the military if they were eligible to. And it's something that, I think is definitely a stain on American history, especially during World War II. It was unnecessary, and it was based upon fear that, Japan was going to send spies in, and there were Japanese spies in the U.S. at that time. But, this, I think, clearly was not the way to handle that problem. And I think that in the long term, obviously hurt the Asian American community by setting them back economically and just within society by kind of removing them from kind of the fixtures of their community, by pulling them out of cities across the country. I think that it obviously unfairly set them back, but it also created a precedent for anti-Japanese sentiment that has lingered for a long time. And we've seen a lot of that change, with even during the pandemic, kind of a renewed calls about the Stop Asian Hate and the discrimination that some Chinese Americans and other Asian Americans faced in the wake of the COVID-19 pandemic. I think that it now more than ever is an important time to kind of reflect on the history of Japanese internment camps and the harm that they caused as just, an evil act in our nation's history. Several of the internment camps, I know there's one in Arkansas that are controlled by the National Park Service and can be visited today. I think it's a good place to go and remember the people whose lives were upended and were moved there. After the war, they were allowed to leave the camps and go back and try to rebuild their lives. And in the 1970s, there were reparations given to the Japanese American community as a way to kind of seek to restore some of the harm caused by their time in the camps. But, nothing really fixes harm like that and discrimination like that. So anyway, it's an important part of FDR's legacy, and it's an important part of American history that, over time has been talked about more and more, but needs to continue to be remembered. And the people whose lives were upended and had to rebuild from nothing at the end of the war, you know, those people's stories deserve to be told.
Oh, there's no question about it. I think you hit the nail on the head. And you brought up exactly what I was going to bring up. Like, it would be like if, say, like at the start of the pandemic, or if, you know, now currently, if either President Trump or if President Biden put a plan in place, you know, obviously we're seeing that like you mentioned, the Stop Asian Hate that really kind of began last year, sort of this movement. It would be like if, you know, because the virus came from Asia, then we should just put all Asians in an internment camp. It was a horrendous decision by FDR. And, you know, obviously, like you said, the stories of those poor people should be told. And again, I'll reiterate, it was without a shadow of a doubt the worst decision he ever made during his time as president. But, you know, another sort of low point of Roosevelt during this war was his failure to respond to the mass extermination of European Jews at the hands of Hitler. And as early as 1942, the White House knew exactly what was going on. But Roosevelt basically did nothing to help Jewish refugees when it was certainly possible that he could have. But he basically his belief on how he could help them was by winning the war, because his belief was if we win the war, we can free the Jews and stop the mass extermination from happening. I just think there's more measures in place that he could have, could have exhibited to possibly help those people. But you know, he knew that winning the war would take a massive attack on European soil, and you know, he ended up, you know, sort of putting that out there, what we know as D-Day, and it was one of the greatest strategic plans ever constructed for a war, and you know, something that Roosevelt deserves a ton of credit for in place along with General Eisenhower. But you know, again, for Roosevelt, this was a massive point in the war, and this is just a little excerpt from his prayer over the radio for these soldiers.
Almighty God, our sons, pride of our nation, this day have set upon a mighty endeavor, a struggle to preserve our republic, our religion, and our civilization, and to set free a suffering humanity.
Again, D-Day was a pivotal point in the war. So just talk about that and how that sort of just completely changed the momentum against the Germans.
Yeah, D-Day, you know, as you said, was one of the most pivotal moments in the war. It was extremely important, and there were a lot of kind of like moving parts to it. One was kind of tricking the Germans into thinking that we were not going to be invading on that beach, and trying to get them to move troops kind of out of the area to kind of open the doorway for our invasion. And then another one was just coordinating and through the Allied forces and the Supreme Allied Commander, they were able to coordinate and be able to kind of create this partnership, this military partnership that, you know, I don't think that there's ever been anything on the same scale as that since, you know, between the Allied forces and going in all together and kind of going all out in this, you know, major attempt to kind of get a leg hold back on mainland Europe. And they did it successfully. And, you know, it was a very costly battle, but, you know, it was one that I think undeniably, you know, resulted in, I think undeniably it, without D-Day, there is no winning the war in Europe. And, you know, we're just over 75 years since the D-Day landing. And, you know, it's crazy to think that it was that long ago, but also that it was that recent, that, you know, we were fighting these battles. And you look at, obviously, Europe is not perfect today, but how far Western Europe has come since World War II. And, you know, I think that the lasting legacy of D-Day is in, you know, the men who lost their lives fighting for freedom, not just in their homes, but abroad and for the people of Europe more widely.
Amen. Amen to that. I mean, as any war is, it was a costly sacrifice for all those who sacrificed and lost their lives, you know, for the cause of freedom, as you mentioned, not just for Americans, but for, you know, all nations involved. And so, but, you know, 5 months after D-Day in the election of 1940, FDR won, in the election of 1944, FDR won again, another unprecedented fourth term in office. Maybe from his perspective, it's understandable that you want to continue to, you want to finish out the war and try to keep the country progressing in the right direction post Great Depression and then hopefully post World War II. But 2020 hindsight, certainly, as we'll see, he'd have been better just, stepping aside and letting a younger, more capable leader stepping in putting the finishing touches on and getting this war out of the way. But, the final meeting between the Allies took place at Yalta in February of 1945, led by Roosevelt, Prime Minister Winston Churchill, and the General Secretary of the Soviet Union, Joseph Stalin. And the Big Three, as they became known as, and some of the stories about the Big Three are just fascinating. So, we don't have enough time to get into it, but I strongly suggest everybody out there listening, go research them. But, it was here that Roosevelt, you mentioned Woodrow Wilson and sort of Woodrow's dream for the League of Nations kind of became fulfilled here at Yalta when the Allied forces came together, when actually it was Roosevelt and Churchill convinced Stalin to sign off on the United Nations, which would be, an international peacekeeping organization and, of course, has persisted to this day. And so, the United Nations comes around. Roosevelt kind of gets done when he needs to get done there, and he comes back to America, and he wants to get some rest. He's very weary. People talked about when he came back, he looked very frail. And on April 12th of 1945, he was resting in Warm Springs, Georgia. He sat down for a portrait for, and I hope I'm saying her name right, for artist Elizabeth Shomatov. And midway through the portrait, which, by the way, actually you can Google the unfinished portrait of FDR. Midway through the portrait, Roosevelt said, quote, "I have a terrible headache." And after uttering those words, he slumped in his chair and fell unconscious. His cardiologist would diagnose the emergency as a cerebral hemorrhage. And within about 3 hours, Franklin D. Roosevelt passed away at the age of 63. And of course, his passing was met with much grief around the nation, but also around the world. Winston Churchill talked about how he was devastated at his passing. And so just talk about, I'll throw this in, for a lot of Americans, they hadn't really known an America without FDR being president. Mm-hmm. And so just talk about just the public grief and mourning, because I think in some ways, like Warren G. Harding, it just sort of came out of nowhere.
Yeah, no, it definitely did to most Americans. And FDR's health had been not rapidly declining in a super concerning way, but, his health, there had been some concerns among staff members kind of leading up to this that he needed to kind of slow down a little bit, and that the stresses of the war and of the office of president were kind of getting to him. But, publicly, that was not something that was known or being discussed at all. His death definitely shocked the American people. And I think that, in a lot of ways, he was kind of an encapsulation of the American war effort and of recovery. You think it is hard to picture the Great Depression and World War II at the same time when you think about it. Like, the way that, the country had so radically transformed during his time in office. And, you brought up that there are some Americans at that time that had, memory that literally could not imagine anyone else being president, because he had been the only president for, their entire lifetimes. And obviously those would be, that would be like teenagers, like young teenagers.
Right.
I think his death in some ways, reinvigorated the American people towards the war effort. And it kind of became a championing cause to kind of see out the end of the war kind of in FDR's name and in memory of him. And, but I think that, at the same time, it was also really hard. It's hard on top of the war effort and all the horrors of war to also lose the president of the United States. And, Harry S. Truman going in to office as president after that, he had only been vice president for the beginning of that fourth term, not even a full year. So you also have this uncertainty of this new figure that was not well known. And there was, quite frankly, not a lot of confidence in. And we'll talk about that in the next episode. But, it was very uncertain times. It was uncertainty on top of existing uncertainties. And, you know, I think from both ends, I think that on one side, I think that it helped people kind of rally around the war and kind of one last, like, this is, let's end it once and for all for FDR. I think that that was one outcome of his death. But I think on the other end, I think that it just reminded people even more than they had already been reminded that these were uncertain times. They did not know what was going to happen, and that these events were kind of outside of their control.
Right. And, you know, again, it was sort of the symbolic end of an era for him, because, you know, look, we think about, you know, we think about the greatest presidents, and really I've always believed this. The reason the greatest presidents are known as such is because they succeeded and guide the country through our greatest, you know, crises. The reason the worst presidents are ranked where they're at is because they, or at least most of the worst presidents, a crisis was dealt, and they just, you know, they weren't able to get us through it. And you know, in FDR's case, he was handed two. Now that was, of course, in part because he did run for that third and brief fourth term. But you know, it was sort of his leadership, obviously, I wouldn't say youthful exuberance, but his energy that he brought to the White House, his energy he brought to the country through the fireside chats, through you know, his policies that he put in place, agree with them or disagree with them, and that was really the legacy of FDR. So any final words before we wrap up this episode, at least on just first of all on FDR?
You know, I think that he's a complex figure. I don't think that, you know, I think you could do an entire podcast on him and not cover everything in his yes. life or even just in his presidency. You know, I think that, all I can really say is I would encourage, you know, the listeners, if they're interested in learning more about him, to seek out other sources. I know the FDR Presidential Library and Museum is a really good source, to learning more about his life that, tends to accurately and fairly display, the good and bad aspects of his legacy. I know that there are other great sources out there, but I would just encourage people, that if they want to know more, that we really only covered the surface, and we talked about him for quite a while, and that's because there's so much to talk about when it comes to FDR. So I think that's really what I would say is just, you know, if you want to learn more about him, there are a lot of great resources out there, and there's a lot more to learn about him.
100%. And you know, he's obviously one of the most well-known Americans, certainly of the 20th century, but also, you know, one of the most influential Americans, you know, obviously in terms of, you know, presidents, but in not just where the country is, but because of World War II, where the world is today, the contributions of the United States and of Roosevelt, you know, along with Churchill and Joseph Stalin. So, but you know, His like you said, I mean, there's a lot to dive into, and you know, presidential libraries are often the best source to research if you want to, you know, look at a certain president. But so we come to the end of episode 6. We covered a lot today, man. I think this has been our longest episode to date. Two world wars, a depression, you know, two presidents passed in office. I mean, it was a very consequential time in our history and in the 20th century. So sort of, if you could put a bow on this episode and then sort of what we're going to be transitioning to in the following episode.
Yeah, I think that, you know, we just went through the progressive era. You know, that was kind of the second half of it. And I would kind of cap it as the end of the American progressive era. Even though those themes will continue. We saw an era of, you know, the solidification of America's standing as a world power. And we also saw both political parties starting to be more shaped by the ideals that we are used to them having. This is kind of setting up the modern era, through a lot of hardship and bloodshed. But, you know, now for the next episode, I'd say, you know, welcome to modern America. Yes. You know, we're going to see the end of World War One, the beginning of the Cold War.
World War II.
Oh, my goodness. World War II. I really...
Hey, listen, we've been on here for two and a half hours. you can have a misstep here or there. There's no shame in that whatsoever.
But we're going to see the end of World War II, the beginnings of the Cold War, and you know, we're going to see a whole new political landscape with new figures who he, you know, we've only mentioned one of them, I think, in this episode at the very end, which is Truman. You know, this is modern America. It's a new generation that's in charge. There's new issues that they're facing, and America. For the first time, we're going to be talking about America as solely a world power. I think that is going to change a lot of the themes that we're going to see in the issues that presidents are facing.
100%. There's going to be domestic issues without a doubt, but the worldwide issues that the United States, because we are now a, you know, at the top, maybe not the top of the food chain. I don't want to sound like an Eric. Episode without a question. I think my connection just went out. I think Isaac's just went out. So but like to get him back in here for just a quick second to sort of wrap up this episode. But yeah, it's you know, we are now becoming a world power in that, like I said, world issues are being brought to our table. It's not just the European powers, but it's others, you know, with you know, the powers that be out there. So Isaac just DM'd me and said his connection just went out. So I'll go ahead and wrap up the episode. But you know, listen, it was a pivotal point in our history. And you know, without leaders like FDR, you know, this country and the world could look like a very, very different place. So he deserves a ton of credit. And with that, that was all the time we have for today. 2.5 hours, man. We covered a lot, but hope everybody has a great day out there. Be sure to check out episode 7 of the Carving It Up U.S. Presidents Edition. I will be here. Isaac will be here. And we'll keep things rolling in that direction towards where we are today. So have a great day, everybody. Stay safe out there. God bless you all. Peace out.